Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning. I would like to start off by welcoming all of our online viewers attending through YAF's virtual pass. If you're participating through Facebook or YouTube, I'd invite you to sign up through to participate through YAF's virtual pass at yaf.org/virtualpass, where you can submit questions for Dr. Schweikart to answer live. Dr. Larry Schweikart is a former rock drummer who opened for Steppenwolf, an American historian and the author of more than a dozen books. Throughout high school and college, Dr. Schweikart spent most of his time playing drums in a variety of rock bands, and in 1972, upon graduation, he joined a band called Goldmine, led by John Tatum, formerly of the Earwigs, which was the forerunner to Alice Cooper. He played in several other groups before joining Rampage, a southern rock group that opened for Steppenwolf. The band cut several records, one of which had limited release and was reviewed by Billboard and Record World. Leaving the band in the mid-1970s, he returned to Arizona, where he re-entered ASU to obtain a teaching certificate, taking a history course that inspired him to become a history professor. He entered the ASU master's program, publishing two national Phi Alpha Theta prize-winning articles in consecutive years, at that point, the only time that had ever occurred. Upon receiving the MA, he was admitted to the University of California, Santa Barbara, and had already published his first book, A History of Banking in Arizona. During his study at UCSB, he published his second book, A Study of the Trident Submarine Program, with his former professor at ASU, D. Douglas Dagladesh. In 2004, he co-authored the best-selling U.S. history book, A Patriot's History of the United States. He continues to publish major trade books on national defense, history, and the U.S. economy. Please help me in welcoming Dr. Larry Schweikart to the stage.
All right, welcome, digital patriots. Good to have you with us. All right, so you all got a free copy of Reagan. Well, it's not free. Young America's paid for it. But you all got a free copy to you of Reagan, the American President. It's a great book, even if I do say so myself. Most of you will have a bookmark. I didn't bring enough bookmarks. I didn't know this thing would be packed like this. So for those of you who did not get a bookmark, the really important thing is the very last thing on the bookmark. So please take down this email. If you email me at larry@wildworldofhistory.com, larry@wildworldofhistory.com, I'll send you a free Reagan webinar, a free History of American Business webinar. There are some 50 various wild did you know things about history on the site, and you can even see a free preview of my new U.S. history curriculum for Patriots History of the United States. I've developed a full curriculum. Many of you already bought out all the copies I brought of Patriots History of the United States. And it involves me doing video lessons, 22 lessons of Patriots history. I teach every chapter. So if you want to get American history taught to you by me, email me at larry@wildworldofhistory and start there. Let's see, what else do I need to tell you about that? Oh. Patriots History of the United States, many of you know that book. If you don't, shame on you. Patriots History of the United States, of course, a New York Times number one bestseller. It is now in its 30th printing with over 350,000 sold and 500,000 copies in print. And the very latest 15th anniversary edition just came out, and that goes all the way through who shall not be named as president, zero. And the first 2 years of President Trump. So it goes all the way up, really, to 2018. And if you're interested in obtaining an autographed copy of that, talk to me out there afterwards when I'm signing your Reagan books. All right? Okay. Do I have a clicker? Is this my clicker? This is it. Okay. So I did a biography of Ronald Reagan. It started really back in 2010 when I wrote this book, Seven Events That Made America America. And in this book, I looked at seven things in history that you probably never heard of or heard very little of, things like the Johnstown flood or Eisenhower's heart attack that basically changed the way we eat. Eisenhower's heart attack in 1955 started a giant shift toward carbs and away from meat. Panera thanks Eisenhower every day because he had this heart attack, right? I call Panera the house of death. No, just kidding. In one of the chapters was called Reagan's Greatest Mistake, and I looked at Lebanon 1983. And I had to do a lot of work in the Reagan Library, the Reagan Archives, when I wrote that. And I thought, you know what? I bet I could write a biography of Ronald Reagan. Now, the question always comes up is, well, why do we need another biography of Reagan? There's like 50 of them out there. That's a good question, but my answer is, this is the first one that really takes advantage of all of the papers in the Reagan Archives. Lou Cannon, considered one of the better biographers, did not have access to these papers when he wrote his books, and some of the more recent books, I found out they only walked into the papers for a day or so and then left. They didn't spend any time at all. So this is a deep inside look at Reagan. The other reason I thought we needed a new biography is I didn't think people got Reagan. Reagan is who he was. He's who he appeared to be in front of Americans. You cut him, he bled red, white, and blue. This guy was a patriot, and you saw who he was up front. There was no hidden Reagan, no person to be psychoanalyzed. Who's the real Ronald Reagan back here? We know who he was, right? He's this guy. So let's take a look at Reagan's life. Some of these things you may know, some of them you might not. Born in Illinois, he grew up in knocking around in various towns in Illinois, Tampico, Chicago, Dixon. And as a young man, Reagan was a lifeguard at the Rock River. While lifeguard, Ronald Reagan saved 77 people from drowning. Now, I submit to you that if Ronald Reagan died at age 25, he still would have been an American hero just because of that. He went to Eureka College, a small Christian school, and he wanted to play football. There was a problem in that he was nearly blind. He had real trouble seeing things, so he couldn't be a quarterback. You know, kind of need to see a wide receiver to throw him the ball. And so they made him a lineman. They said, block the shape in front of you. And so he could do that pretty well. So he ended up playing football at Eureka, but he didn't have very good grades. Okay, now any parents or adults who are listening, tune out for a second. You don't need to have good grades to succeed. I didn't quite flunk out of Arizona State the first time, but I didn't get A's or B's. I got like C minuses and stuff. You know, I got several D's because I was playing rock and roll music every night. I didn't care about school. Reagan was the same way. He was interested in acting. He was interested in football. He was interested in girls. He was not all that interested in grades. He did major in economics, and he picked up quite a bit in economics. Many years later, Reagan was invited back to Eureka College to receive an honorary degree, and he said, well, I always thought the first degree I got was honorary, right? So he didn't get good grades. After what you almost never hear of, and I don't know any other biographer who's really talked about this, did you know Ronald Reagan is our only American president to lead a student protest march? While he was at Eureka, the president of Eureka canceled a number of senior level classes because of financial difficulties. But he also did something really stupid. He canceled the school dance. Now, Eureka College was a Christian school and it prohibited dancing, but they had a single school dance called the grind. I know that sounds really, it's not what you think. In the grind, the boys would line up in a circle facing inward, and the girls would get in a circle inside facing outward. And they'd start the music. They used to have these things called record players, okay? And you would put a needle on the record player, and it would play the music. Anyway, they would start dancing in opposite directions twerking or I don't know, whatever. And when the music stopped, they'd pick up the needle. You were supposed to talk to the girl or boy right across from you. And this is how the students learned to their schoolmates to introduce to each other. So school banned that, and they canceled these senior level classes. Well, the seniors called a school-wide meeting. All students showed up, 11 o'clock Friday night, and they said, we want to drive this president out. We want to force him to resign. But we seniors can't lead this because it's too self-serving, because it's our classes that are getting canceled, right? We need a freshman. And Reagan's, because he already had a reputation in speech and drama club. And so Reagan ends up leading this protest march that calls a school-wide boycott that is so effective that only six students refused to go out on boycott, and two of those were the president's daughters. And the president was forced out. So Ronald Reagan, student activist. After he gets out of, sort of like Dino Bernie. After he gets out of Eureka, Reagan goes to become a sports announcer. And he's announcing for the Chicago Cubs in Iowa. Now, I don't know if you guys know your geography. The Chicago Cubs play in Chicago. They don't play in Iowa. So he had to get the games via a teletape. And he would sit there and over the microphone, he would enact or enhance the games from the teletype that he got, you know, strike one. And he, oh, that was a massive swing, something like that, right? One day the teletype broke. And Reagan had to make up the game for 7 minutes on air while nothing was happening, right? And, oh, there's a foul ball. Boy, that was a long one. It's going to take a while to get that one back. Oh, the pitcher shakes off a sign. Oh, pitcher gets off the mound. He goes on for 7 minutes till finally the teletype started up again. He found out the batter flied out on the first pitch. Reagan goes out to San Diego with the Cubs for spring training. Now, he made an acquaintance of a young lady in Dixon who was an actress, and she had some working jobs in Hollywood. And she got Reagan a screen test with two studios. And I can't remember which the other one was, but the one that counts is Warner Brothers. Reagan got a screen test with Warner Brothers. And then he had to go back to Iowa to do his announcing gig. So he gets off the train in Iowa, and a guy comes running up to him from the Western Union office. He says, Mr. Reagan, I've got a telegram for you from your agent out there in California. And it said, Warner Brothers wants to sign you at X number of years for Y number of dollars. And Reagan immediately goes to the Western Union office and sends him back a telegram and says, sign quick before they change their minds. So he ends up being an actor. Something else you probably didn't know about Reagan, he wasn't a very good actor. He wasn't a great actor because he didn't want to be a great actor. How many of you have seen Dark Knight with Heath Ledger as a Joker, right? There is a great actor. It literally killed him. That role killed him, okay? Christian Bale. I've seen him in movies where I didn't even recognize him for half the movie. He had lost so much weight. So Reagan didn't want to do that. Reagan would not play roles that were not good guy roles. He only played one villain his entire life. That was his very last movie, The Killers, which was a bomb. Okay, he would say of himself, you know that guy that runs in and picks up the phone and says, hold the presses, have I got a story for you? That's me. See, that's how he saw himself as an actor. However, he did end up with two really great roles. One was as George Gipp, the football player for Newt Rockne All-American, in which Gipp was dying of some disease, and Newt Rockne comes to the bedside, and Reagan, as Gipp says, Coach, sometimes when the boys are up against it, tell them to go out there and win just one for the Gipper. And by that, he got the nickname the Gipper. So if you hear him referred to, that's what that is a movie role. He already had another nickname, Dutch. Because his dad said when he came out as a baby, he looked like a little Dutchman. His face was so red. So here he is. He's not even 30 years old, and he's got two nicknames already. That's pretty cool. As I said, he's not a great actor, but he does have one really great role, and that's in a movie called King's Row, where he played Drake McHugh, who was a wealthy socialite playboy, and was in love with a girl whose father was a doctor. In the movie, Drake loses all of his money, ends up working in the railroad yards, and two railroad cars come together on his legs and crush his legs. And of all people he's taken to for medical help, it's the dad. And instead of fixing his legs, the dad amputates him. And in the famous scene, Reagan wakes up and he goes, "Where's the rest of me?" Right, and he shot that on the first take, by the way. He should have been given an Academy Award nomination for that, but back at the time, the studios decided who got the Academy Award nominations, and they gave it to Spencer Tracy instead. However, where are we going? Oh, I did it again. Britney Spears. However, through his wife, Jane Wyman, he's introduced to the Screen Actors Guild, or SAG. Now, if you ever saw Team America World Police, you'll know the joke there, right? But Screen Actors Guild was the union for all of the actors. And Reagan eventually becomes president of SAG and is an incredibly effective union president. All right, so trivia question. What two American presidents, only two American presidents, have been members of a major union? Ronald Reagan and Donald Trump, Screen Actors Guild. Because when Trump was doing a Celebrity Apprentice, he had to belong to Screen Actors Guild. So Reagan ends up negotiating a number of contracts. He also ends up battling communists in Hollywood. Communists had infiltrated Hollywood like crazy. Wait a minute, what's new? Okay, so they're all over Hollywood, and Reagan got the movie studios to basically purge the communists from the ranks there. He was called before the House Un-American Affairs Committee to testify, and the House committee thought he was really going to bash Hollywood. Boy, he's going to talk about how horrible those studios are, and he didn't. He goes up and he says, "Well, we used to have communists. We got rid of them." He said, "I would never want to see free speech censored. I would never want to see any kind of censorship on speech in America." And then he goes on to quote Thomas Jefferson, which had to shock these congressmen who probably never heard of Thomas Jefferson. Who's this guy he's quoting? This Jefferson guy? So he becomes a very effective president of SAG. In the 1950s, he ends up seeing that his movie career isn't going to go very far. So he starts a career in television. Now, television was really looked down on in the 50s, if you're a movie actor. But he found an opportunity to work with General Electric Company in what was called GE Theater, General Electric Theater. And Reagan would host an episode every week, and once a month he would star in an episode. And it featured the top Hollywood talent because it allowed these actors and actresses to come in and they got to choose their roles. So if you always played a villain, you got to finally play a hero for a change. But the other part of Reagan's GE gig was that he had to go around to all of the General Electric factory shop floors and make speeches. And he would make speeches on current events and other topics, which is where he got his famous 3x5 cards, where he would hold up a card that had just 3 points on it. Remember, he doesn't have the best eyesight. And then he would take questions and answers from the audience. And some of these are pretty funny. At one, he was speaking at an all-female workforce that GE had at one of the plants. And this is his words, not mine, so don't get all over me. But his words, he said, "A bull of a woman came up to me and said, 'Buster, I'd like to back you into a corner.'" And Reagan said, "It'd have to be a pretty big corner." Because of his understanding of politics, economics, and the world that unfolded through GE, he was asked by the Goldwater campaign in 1964 to make a national one-hour speech for Goldwater for president called "A Time for Choosing." And in this speech, while it wasn't the first time he used the phrase "rendezvous with destiny," it's the one most people remember. And he said, "You and I have a rendezvous with destiny." And this speech was so good that when it was over, all of the Republican brass looked at each other and go, "We nominated the wrong guy. Should have nominated him." But they did go on to push him to run for governor of this state, California. And so in 1966, Reagan runs for and wins the governorship of California. Here's another thing you almost never heard of. The most key person in Reagan becoming governor of California was his brother, Neil. Neil was a very powerful advertising executive in California. He knew all the guys who had money, and he got all of them behind Reagan in his run for the governorship. Now, Reagan had a small problem. He didn't like to fly. He was afraid of flying. And so one day, Neil calls him up. Reagan's up in San Francisco. Neil's down in Los Angeles. And Neil says, do you want to be governor? And Reagan goes, well, yes. He goes, okay, then tomorrow you need to be at the Coconut Grove in Los Angeles. I've got a meeting with all these donors, and it's at 11 in the morning. He goes, well, I'd have to fly. And Neil said, do you want to be governor? And hung up the phone. Next day, Reagan was there. You never heard another thing about him being afraid to fly after that. After his governorship, which was judged a success by liberals and conservatives, he ran for president against an incumbent Republican, Gerald Ford. Now, that's really hard to do, to run against a president of your own party. But Reagan came very close, within a couple hundred delegates, of actually winning the nomination in 1976. He had tried kind of a lukewarm run in 1968 against Nixon that failed. This is interesting. In 68, they thought Reagan was too old to be president. In 76, they really think, they haven't seen Dino Bernie yet, right? In 76, or Bite Me, who can't even keep his teeth in his mouth. Let me tell you, his teeth go flying out. Now, where was I? Oh, yeah, man. Anyway, so in 76, they really thought Reagan was too old to run. His whole family, everybody in his family, opposed him running for president in 76. He loses, as I said, the nomination to the incumbent president, Gerald Ford, who turns around and loses to this guy, Jimmy Carter. Now, if you want to look in your index there, the chapter on Carter and this period is called The Worst President Ever. There's an asterisk next to it. If you look at the bottom of the page, it says, except for Barack Obama. So, Carter, we're not going to go into a lot of what made Carter a horrible president, but he had problems with the economy, he had problems with foreign policy, there was a hostage situation going on. He's ripe for the picking, and Reagan runs against him in 1980 and leads through the whole campaign right up until October. And then all of a sudden, Dick Werthlin, Reagan's pollster, comes to him and says, Governor, we got a problem. Carter just went ahead of us in my polling. He says, I think you need to debate him. Carter had been begging Reagan for a debate, and of course the rule is the front runner never debates because he doesn't need to. So Reagan agreed to a debate. It's the only debate of the 1980 presidential campaign, and it came 10 days out from the election. This is the latest debate ever held in American presidential history. And Reagan wins that debate with four words. Carter was hammering him on all sorts of Medicare and Medicaid statistics, and it was stuff that just kind of goes over the head of most Americans. And Reagan's just kind of humoring him, looking at him like, boy, are you out of touch? And finally, Reagan gets a chance to speak, and he goes, there you go again. And with those four words, he made Carter look small and insignificant, and Reagan look like the adult in the room. And he won by such a landslide that on election night, Reagan is taking a shower, getting ready to go down to headquarters to look at the returns, and Nancy comes in to him and says, Ronnie, you got a phone call from the Oval Office. I think you better take it. And Carter was conceding before the votes had even been counted in California. That's how big Reagan won. As president, Reagan had a twofold agenda of defeating the Soviet Union and building up the American economy. And to Reagan, these were two sides of the same coin. As we got stronger, they got weaker. As our economy got better off, theirs got worse off. Of course, he had a military buildup. You know, he built reinstituted construction of the B-1 bomber, the B-2 bomber, the MX missile. Trident submarine went into the water at this time. By the way, one of my pet peeves is that we name our weapons such stupid names. The B-2 bomber is the Spirit bomber. The MX missiles, the Peacekeeper. Where's the ass kicker? I want the butt smasher bomber, right? So anyway, he gets all these weapons in the pipeline. But he also understands that the way to beat the Soviets is by crushing their economy. Now, the Soviets exported, and still to this day, only export four things: vodka, gold, oil, and spies. He let the CIA handle the spies, and he wasn't going to touch vodka. Reagan didn't drink all that much. But he did go after the gold and the oil sales. And so what he did was he had 6'7" head of the Fed, tall Paul Volcker. He called him in, he said, "I want you to slash inflation. Cut inflation, get the interest rates down." And Volcker was so effective at this. Folks, when I was going to school back then, home mortgage interest rates were 10%. Credit card interest rates were 25%. It was really just crazy. We were bordering on hyperinflation. Volcker cuts inflation down to, during one quarter of 1982, 0%. Absolutely incredible. Well, how does that hurt the Soviets? Well, they only export four things. Remember, one of those is gold. Gold gets all its value from inflation. Gold is a hedge against inflation. You hear all the commercials on TV about all the gold bugs, right? You know, are you worried about the economy? Invest in gold. So when Reagan cuts inflation, the value of a Soviet gold ingot fell tenfold in less than 2 years. I mean, just cuts one of the legs right out from under their economy. As for oil, Reagan brings in the Saudi oil minister and some of his aides, and he says, "Fellas," this is how he would always talk to a group of guys, "Fellas, I think we need to cut the price of oil, increase production." And of course, the Saudis understood this was not a request. So they said, "Okay, what will you give us?" And he goes, "We'll give you some AWACS airplanes, but you're going to cut prices and increase production." What does that do to the Soviets? It cuts the other leg out from under them, and they start going broke, in addition to having to ramp up to meet all of our weapons systems. He forms alliances. We did that before. Go back. There we go. He forms alliances with Pope John Paul II to attack the Soviets spiritually and gains the moral high ground, or with cultural icons. One of the things the Reagan administration did was it began to pump money into Radio Free Europe and Voice of America. Now, these things beamed rock and roll music into Eastern Europe and Russia. And this was hugely important. I did a film called Rockin the Wall back in 2010. Got on PBS. And we interviewed people from behind the Iron Curtain, and we interviewed all these rock and rollers like Toto and Vanilla Fudge and Quiet Riot and The Doors and all these people. And the people from behind the Iron Curtain said, rock and roll was so important to us. It taught us about freedom. And so one of the things we discovered while making this movie is that rock and roll music, which is, by the way, the number one music form in the entire world today. You can't go anywhere and not hear American rock. You go to a karaoke club, and in Japan, they're singing American music, right? I even had a guy tell me he was bicycling through South Africa in the middle of nowhere. He comes around a corner, and there's a guy selling fruit and juices and stuff in a Bob Marley shirt. So, I mean, it's everywhere. So one of the guys we interviewed in Rockin' the Wall was a Hungarian student activist and rock drummer named Leslie Mandoki, M-A-N-D-O-K-I. You Google him, you're going to find all these images of him with people like Bill Clinton and top diplomats and so forth. And one of the guys that he got to be very good friends with was Mikhail Gorbachev. And Gorbachev comes to Mandoki's home in the 1990s and said, "You know, we kept out videos, we kept out movies, we kept out literature. We could never stop rock and roll music." And Gorbachev told Mandoki rock and roll music was fundamental to bringing down the Iron Curtain. In fact, in 1988, Bruce Springsteen, who's certainly no conservative, played a concert in East Berlin because the communists there thought that, hey, this guy's going to, he's going to rag on Reagan, right? He's going to get after Reagan. And Springsteen comes in, he plays a couple of songs, and then he stops and he starts talking. He says, I'm not here to praise or blame any country or political system. And all the commissars go, oh, we have screwed up big time. What's wrong with this, you know? And so then he starts in to his best known song, which is Born in the USA. Now, if you've read the lyrics, because nobody can understand a word Springsteen says, you know. I've been down, kind of center. What? I've been down, kind of center. Say what? Born in the U.S. That's all anybody knows, right? So people think it's a patriotic American song. So here are 80,000 communist Utes, and my cousin Vinny, 80,000 communist Utes going, born in the USA, and they wanted to be born in the USA. Everybody we talked to said, we wish we'd been born in the USA. And the communist commissars are over there, oh, we've really screwed up now. So Reagan took advantage of this. He worked with labor leader in Poland, Lech Walesa, kind of looks like Ted Cruz, right? He formed an alliance with Charlie Wilson. If you haven't seen the movie Charlie Wilson's War, you got to see it. This is one of the few times in which the real person looks better than the actor who played him. Charlie Wilson's a lot more handsome than Tom Hanks. But he got all sorts of weapons, including Stinger anti-aircraft missiles, to the Afghans who were fighting the Russians. Of course, come on. His biggest ally was Margaret Thatcher of Great Britain. Maggie Thatcher, as she was called, was the only woman other than Nancy allowed to call Ronald Reagan, quote, her Ronnie, unquote. And they were fast friends and firm allies. Now, in 1983, really, Ronald Reagan wins the Cold War. It's like that those movies where you see the boxers and the one guy hits the other guy and he's still on his feet for a couple of minutes, you know. But you know he's done. You know he's already out. And this is what happens in 83. Reagan gives a speech called the SDI speech about the Strategic Defense Initiative. He doesn't mention space or lasers in it. He just talks about research and development to try and stop ICBMs, intercontinental ballistic missiles. The media thinks they have him. You know, they're so clueless. They always think they got somebody. All right, we got him now. And they called it Star Wars. Now, in my day, if you wanted to ridicule something as being out there, just totally crazy, you called it Buck Rogers. Because Buck Rogers was this guy who flew around in outer space without even a mask, just breathing that good old space air. You know, they had all these wonderful little ray guns and stuff. My favorite is the one in the bottom there where you can kill an alien and unplug your toilet at the same time. It's sort of the Swiss Army knife of alien killing ray guns. So they call it Star Wars because they think it's going to ridicule the SDI system. But there was a problem. Between the 1950s and 1983, a lot had happened. We put people on the moon many, many times. Americans had walked in space. We had the space shuttle going up all the time. We were using lasers to actually do surgery and industrial engineering. And most important of all, in 1977, the movie Star Wars came out, and everybody either saw it or knew about it, okay? So anybody who saw the movie Star Wars knew that the evil emperor was Brezhnev, the Soviet guy. Look, it's the same guy. I think he auditioned for the part. And that meant that Reagan was Luke. Now, even though there's an age difference, you know, you got that same kind of jaunty, oh, yeah, the Death Star, no problem. The hole we got to hit there is smaller than the head of a womp rat. We can do that, you know? And so you got that whole Luke thing happening there, you know? And, of course, that meant that Gorbachev, or Gorby as I like to call him, was really Darth. And everybody sees him with the helmet, but when you take the helmet off, it's the same pasty-faced little guy with a red blotch on his forehead. And that, I swear, that red blotch used to take on the geographical map shape of whatever country the Soviets were invading at the time. And you could tell where they're going. They're going into Afghanistan. Look at his forehead. They're going into Afghanistan, right? So the media did Reagan probably the greatest favor ever by calling it Star Wars, because Americans go, yeah, Star Wars, yeah, we can do it. We can beat the Soviets. In 1988, Reagan took the last major trip as president to Russia. And he goes over there and he does two main things. The first thing he does is he makes a speech at Moscow State University to about 10,000 communist youths. Now, these are young commies in training, you know, so like Harvard. They're learning how to be good young commies, right? And he talks to them about freedom and talks to them about capitalism, and they give him a standing ovation. I mean, it's beyond belief to think that Donald Trump could go to UC Santa Barbara today and give a speech and get a standing ovation from students. But here, Reagan is getting a standing ovation from communist youths. The other thing that he does is he starts talking about God. In his very first meeting with people, which are a group of religious dissidents, and all the press is there, Reagan's talking about God. God, 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 God. And they're having to write this down and publicize it, which is huge, because the word God had not been uttered publicly in Soviet society for 80 years or 70 years, right? And here's Reagan, God, God, God. Or if you're a Pentecostal, it's God. And Jesus is a three-syllable word in Pentecostalese, Jesus. Okay, so he's talking to all of these people about God, and get this, and nobody else has caught this. Reagan says, I want to convert Mikhail Gorbachev to Christianity. And he gets Gorby aside, and he says, Mikhail, how are things with your soul? And Gorbachev's taken aback, you know, and he says, well, I was baptized as a child, but of course I am a communist. And Reagan hammers him, you know, gently and politely, but he starts saying, you know, you need to think about this. And after Reagan leaves, Gorbachev writes him a letter and says, I am thinking about these things very deeply. Reagan always used to love to ride. And there's pictures all over the place of him in his riding gear, but I don't know if you caught this. He's in English riding gear. And what's interesting is the first time he was asked to do a promotional picture, he comes out in English riding gear, and the photographer, no, man, cowboy stuff. Oh, and he walks back and gets the cowboy hat and the boots. But he frequently liked to ride like this. So after he retires from the presidency, goes back home, he's riding with Nancy in New Mexico. His horse throws him, and he hits his head on a rock, and he has a bleeding of the skull, and they have to drill a couple holes in his head to relieve the pressure. Nancy dates the memory Alzheimer's issues from that moment on. And so in 1994, he starts having really horrible memory losses. He literally repeats a full paragraph from a speech he was giving in honor of Margaret Thatcher, repeats the whole thing. He literally repeats, oh wait, sorry, I'm not Joe Biden. And so Nancy has him undergo some tests, and they go, yes, he has Alzheimer's. And he writes his famous letter to the American public. Now, in his waning years, the one thing he loves to do is ride. And he still had a Secret Service agent assigned to him who had to ride with him. When he was president, he had a team of Secret Service agents that had to do everything he did. And he would jump his horse over fences, ride along, and these poor Secret Service guys had to ride, jump their horses. And finally, he saw they were having trouble and goes, fellas, I've decided not to do any more jumps. They go, thank you, Mr. President. So after he has this memory issue, he's still riding, and his Secret Service agent is John Barletta, and one day Reagan has real trouble on the ride. And so Barletta comes in and talks to Nancy, and he says, Mrs. Reagan, he had real trouble out there. He shouldn't ride anymore. And she says, well, you got to tell him, John. So Barletta goes in, and watch this. He says, Mr. President, we had a lot of trouble out there today, didn't we? And Reagan says, no, John, I had a lot of trouble out there. He wouldn't allow Barletta to participate in his failing. And so he has to stop riding. He dies in 2004. And probably the greatest monument to Ronald Reagan is that giant part of the Berlin Wall up at the Reagan Library. at his funeral proceedings, which took place at the library and at the Capitol in Washington, D.C., hundreds of thousands of people came out. They lined the highways. They held up signs. Fire trucks would have giant American flags, and the media couldn't believe it. It's the same way with Trump. This is a guy they hated. They can't believe he was this loved. And so in the end, I think you could say that the American public rose up and won just one for the Gipper. And with that, I'm happy to take your questions. While we're getting set up here, you follow me on Twitter, at Larry Schweikart. You may have to get used to some of the nicknames. It keeps me out of Twit jail or Twitmo. And so I have nicknames for all of our favorite people. Like Nancy Pelosi is Botoxic. Mitch McConnell is Yertle. So anyway, yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Students, if you would like to line up in the back, like usual, for questions. Our first question is from a virtual past participant.
That would be you guys.
Lulu from Richmond asks, how do you think Ronald Reagan would react to today's conservative movement?
I think Reagan would be standing up and applauding. You have to understand that times change. Abraham Lincoln was a great stump speaker. But did you know that Abraham Lincoln had a high, screechy voice? 4 score and 20 years, you know. He would not do well on radio. But in the 1930s, there was a guy who had a wonderful radio voice named Franklin D. Roosevelt. My friends, and you are my friends. Perfect. But Roosevelt would not do well on television because he was in a wheelchair. They kept it really, really secret. But he had polio, and he had to wear braces when he walked around. And back then, there's a real stigma against that. So he wouldn't have done well in Reagan's age. Reagan, of course, is perfect for television. He had a photographic memory. He could memorize his speeches and never have to look at the teleprompter, so he's always looking at the audience. He had perfect timing. I mean, I love Trump's speeches, but let's face it, Donald Trump doesn't have very good timing. He steps on his lines a lot. He blows the applause lines a lot. And the speeches are great. He just doesn't have that same Reagan timing. But today, Reagan would not work. He wouldn't work because the culture has changed. You can't get an hour on TV around the media elites. So I think Reagan would love today's conservative movement. Next up.
Hi, my name is Charlotte.
Hi, Charlotte.
I live in Seattle, Washington, and I go to Skyline High School.
Okay.
And I've read in a lot of different places that President Reagan, and like under his presidency, the federal debt raised like double or three times.
Yep.
And I was wondering why that is.
Okay, when Reagan came in, he really had three major objectives. One was to restore the American economy, beat the Soviets, control the growth of government, right? He found out, as Trump is finding out, there are only so many hours in a day, and Trump only sleeps 3 hours a night, right? There's only so many hours a day. There's only so much political capital. I mean, all of us, we only have so much energy to do so many things, right? And he just decided early on the war against against big government had to take third place behind the economy and the Soviets.
Thank you.
Sure.
Hi, my name is Juana. I'm from Gurnee, Illinois, and I go to Warren Township High School.
Okay.
So my question is, was there ever a party switch? Because I know a lot of conservatives disagree of there ever being a party switch, and some say that there was a party switch, and I haven't found a solid answer.
You mean, did the Democrats become the party of the world, all that kind of
yes.
BS? Yes. No. Look, the Bible tells us that you cannot get good fruit from a bad tree. And the Democratic Party is flat out a bad tree. Take a look at my book, Seven Events That Made America, Chapter 1, and you'll understand how the party was conceived to preserve and protect slavery. That is the organizing principle of the Democrat Party. All the way through the 1880s and 90s, they were still doing that, and they had a military arm called the Ku Klux Klan that enforced that. Today's conservatives under Trump are exactly like the conservatives of Lincoln. They're fighting for freedom. Lincoln believed in tariffs. Teddy Roosevelt believed in tariffs. George Washington believed in tariffs, not just to have taxes out there, but in order to make sure there's a fair playing field. So I thoroughly reject the notion that there's been any kind of party switch. The Democrats concealed it for about 30 years, their true nature, but they have always been the party of big government and slavery.
All right. Thank you so much.
Hi, my name is Laura, and I live in Ellensburg, Washington. I go to Ellensburg High School.
Oh, so you know my co-author, Mike Allen, who lives in Ellensburg.
Yeah, okay. I actually had a history professor that talked about your book, and correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe it was written in response to the People's History of the United States.
Kinda. Is that your question?
No, I was wondering, you know, if you did, and also... you know, if you got any backlash for that, or if...
Backlash? They hate us. Sure. I mean, if you do anything really good, they're going to hate you. The story behind Patriot's History of the United States was I had written a whole bunch of books that nobody read. History of Banking in Arizona, Banking in the American South. Gee, bestsellers, right? Up there with Stephen King. And Mike and I were tired of writing stuff that nobody read. And so plus the other thing was we wanted a good solid US history textbook that we could ourselves use in our own classes. So we started writing Patriot's History of the United States and finished in 2004, and it came out and it kind of did just okay, the publisher renamed it Patriot's History. Our original title was The Cup of Hope. Anyway, so it comes out, does pretty well, and then it kind of just settles down into a little bit of routine sales and so forth. And then in 2010, Glenn Beck had me on his show. Now, at that time, Glenn Beck, who's he today? But back then, Glenn Beck in 2010 was the most powerful media figure out there except for Oprah. He had 3.5 million nightly viewers. Folks, that's seven times what CNN has on a given night. And so I give him a copy of Patriot's History, and he goes, I know this book. Do I know this book? No. The right response is, this is a great book, right? So I knew he hadn't read the book. And so I get a call from Beck 4 days later at home. Larry, this is Glenn. I hadn't read your book when you were on the show, he says, but I read it over the weekend, 1,000-page book, right? This is a great book. And he starts holding it up on his show every single night saying, you got to get this best history book ever written, so on and so forth. And it goes straight to the top of Amazon. And pretty soon I get a call from the publisher. Hey, your book's going to be on the New York Times list. Now, this is 6 years after it appeared. Wow, that's good. That's great. Wonderful. Week later, hey, your book's going to be in the top 10 of the New York Times. I go, yay, way to go. Next week, I get the call. I can hear it over the speakerphone. They're all partying in the background of the publisher's office. Woo! I know what they're doing. I know what they're doing. And your book's going to be number one on the New York Times list. I said, wow, that's great. That's wonderful. They said, no, you don't get it. It's going to be number one on the Times list. I said, no, I heard you. That's wonderful. No, you don't get it. It's going to be in Target and Costco and Walmart. I said, wait a minute. Our book's going to be in Walmart? Thank you, Jesus. Because it meant that we were getting, what did I tell you? We were getting out into the hands of ordinary people, and that's who we wanted to have read the book. Now, yes, we debate Zen in it, but that wasn't the primary reason we wrote the book.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is James Gamboa from Camarillo, California. I go to Beacon Hill Classical Academy, and I was wondering... someone asked a question earlier about the national debt. How do you think we deal with said debt?
Okay, great question. I am a heretic on this matter. I don't think the debt's a big deal. And here's why. I am 68 years old, folks, and I have heard about how the national debt's going to kill us for 58 years. And we're still here. Okay, now, go to any economist. What are the symptoms that debt should spark? What are the things that big debt should cause to happen? Gold prices should soar. Anybody see gold prices soaring? Oil prices should be $10 a gallon. Anybody see that except here in California where you tax it? No. No commodities are soaring at all in terms of price levels, okay? My personal theory, I think George Gilder may kind of support me on this, I'm not sure, is that in the 1990s, we had such an explosion of productivity with computers that literally we haven't caught up, and our valuations still are lagging behind the real prices. And I give you as an example a phone, if I can get mine to work. There. It had on poker. That's the problem. You take this, okay, so the way we previously would value a product, so you take a rotary phone, anybody remember a rotary phone? I forget I'm talking, yeah. So you take a rotary phone, how would you measure the improvement in value of a rotary phone? You take the next rotary phone, you see if it's faster and works a little bit better, right? But this isn't a phone. It's a phone, it's a calculator, it's a gaming device, it's a stock market checker, it's an internet device, it's a writing device, it's a GPS, it's a Twitter device. I mean, all sorts of things you can use this for, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of apps, and I maintain that to properly value this, you would have to go into every single one of those apps and compare it to the previous iteration of what that thing did, and if you did that, this phone would be $7,000, right? But it's not. So that's a long answer to say, I don't think yet we're seeing any impact of the debt. I'm not sure why, that's my take on it. But if I've got 10 issues to deal with in front of me, it's immigration, it's Democrats are number 2 through 9, and the deficit's like 11.
All right, thank you.
Sure.
I'm Schweikart.
Hi, Evan.
I'm good. My name is Evan Hamilton. I reside in Santa Barbara. And I have a question for you. Who is a better president, Calvin Coolidge or Reagan?
Ooh, that's a toughie. In my list of great American presidents, Washington is by far the best. There's just nobody to compare with Washington. Lincoln is second because he keeps the country together when very easily it could have fallen apart. I have Reagan third greatest president, and I have Coolidge fourth. Okay, but Trump is rapidly getting in my top 10 and could be number 5 before too long.
In fourth place?
Coolidge would be behind Reagan because, A, he didn't serve a full 8-year term. He was only elected to one term. And a lot of the policies for which we give Coolidge credit were actually put in place by Warren G. Harding and Harding's Secretary of the Treasury, Andrew Mellon. Mm-hmm. So if Coolidge had come in on his own and had that kind of performance, I'd say he might deserve to be higher up there.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
We have another virtual pass question.
I'll give a virtual answer.
Mary from Indiana asks, who is one modern historian you would recommend all students read to learn more?
Paul Johnson, the British historian. He started off as a newspaper editor. He's got an absolutely photographic mind. His book, Modern Times, was the inspiration for me to write my Patriot's History of the Modern World. It's big, like me. He writes big books. He's got a lot of names in there. He just knows these people. But I'd say Paul Johnson.
We have one more final virtual pass question.
Okay.
Hayden from New Hampshire asks, how do you think the country today would be different without President Reagan?
Oh, boy. Well, if Jimmy Carter had won that election, I'm not sure we'd still have a country here. I mean, it was really disastrous. The first 4 years that he had the country, he drove us into the ground. And he had canceled all of our major weapons programs. The level of respect in the country was at a minimum. And you have to figure that if Carter had won in 80, Reagan really would have been too old, perceived to be too old to run in 1984, and we probably would have gotten George H.W. Bush running in 84 instead of 88. Now, let me say two things. At the end of your Reagan book, there is an appendix called Similarities Between Donald Trump and Ronald Reagan. I think you ought to take a look at that. They're both divorcees, both men who had adult children in the White House. As I said, they're the only ones to hold a union card. They both were hated by the press. They both were disliked by large segments of their own party. So there's a lot of similarities, more than people want to admit, between Donald Trump and Ronald Reagan. And I'm doing a Joe Biden moment here. I can't remember what the other thing was I wanted to tell you. Okay, so I think we're done here. Thank you guys very much. Email me, and I'll send you the information.
So you want your safe space. The last thing you want is somebody invading your campus. You should always feel like you're right.
Freedom is not an abstraction. It affects our happiness and our ability to flourish.
It is very seldom that liberty of any kind is lost all at once. It's always lost bit by bit.
We have protection of freedom of speech. If we said only things that other people liked, we'd have no reason to protect it.
Notice that when Jefferson looks for a source of our rights, can only find one, and that's the Creator.
We are a country that respects religious liberty. That key value has been enshrined in our founding documents.
We are created equal in the eyes of God, the core principle of democracy.
To believe that Islam is a religion of peace is to believe that Muslims throughout history have misunderstood their own religion.
Life is the most fundamental right. None of the other rights that are listed in the Bill of Rights actually exist without first the right to life.
Free markets fundamentally run on service, not to make everyone's outcomes equal. We are diverse people with diverse skills and diverse talents.
Femininity is one of the graces of our world, one of the things that makes life worth living. Feminism has sucked all the joy out of that.
They've attacked manliness itself. They've attacked the virtues. Virtue comes from vir, it means man.
To pretend that a man is a woman, if he believes he is a woman, nobody should be mistreated. But that's not the same thing as requiring that people say objectively untrue things. If I believe I am something that I am not, it does not make me that thing.